Welcome to the Kaiser Report. I'm Max Kaiser, Russian-American intellectual and essayist. Clifton Fadiman opined, cheese is milk's leap toward immortality. Indeed, it's in the nature of all things to seek it, even milk. And to mock it, well, then, as Russian author Dostoevsky warned, if you were to destroy the belief in immortality in mankind, not only love, but every living force on which the continuation of all life in the world depended would dry up at once. No wonder our disposable economy, with its disposable workers making disposable products upon which indisposable bankers execute spoof disposable trades, is dried up. Mortal. Nothing. Stacy.
Immortality is in the headlines, partly because of the disposable opinions of our foreign policy masters. Is Vladimir Putin immortal? Picture from almost 100 years ago seems to show him looking fighting fit.
What?
So somebody found online some conspiracy theorists, as I call it, and this is the Telegraph, by the way, a broadsheet here in the UK, showing photos from 1920, 1941, and 2015 of who they say is Vladimir Putin.
Yes.
Throughout the days.
I can see Vladimir Putin from 100 years ago and 100 years hence.
Whoa!
He's in the future. It's all happening.
And that, by the way, is Max Kaiser's great-great-grandfather's T-shirt. It's even back in the 1800s, your great-great-grandfather had that
Wherever
on his
you
T-shirt.
Look, you see Vladimir Putin.
The Telegraph even did a poll. Is Vladimir Putin immortal? I checked yes, partly because of course, he will live on in history, in the history books. 65% said yes, 35% no. And then the Telegraph took it down because they were mocked so mercilessly. And I think it's partly to do with the fact that John Kerry flip-flopped and suddenly had flat-footed, you know, all these, the mainstream media and the BBC News here had been, like, pushing, you know, the whole U.S. Policy in Syria. And now Kerry goes to Moscow and it's like, oh, we're gonna go with Putin instead.
Well, this is where British humor, so-called, comes from. The U.S. zagged. And the UK is supposed to zag along with the US and flip-flop and go from being anti-Russia, anti-Putin, to getting with the program and understanding that Kerry, John Kerry, as Secretary of State, is now embracing Putin as the only real viable solution in Syria. So they can't really zag fast enough. So they put out a poll, the Telegraph would put out a poll like this to try to make it seem as though, oh, ho, ho, we never really took that propaganda seriously that we pushed just last week. And this is supposedly British humor.
Well, also, they're, of course, trying to subtly demonize that, like, he sucks the blood out of people, and he's, like, you know, Dick Cheney ripping hearts out of people and taking their hearts for himself. Like.
Right, and then they take it down within minutes because they realize suddenly that they're even more of a hellacious, self-parodying, self-vomiting organ of stupidity than even they themselves understand.
So here is Max Kaiser, immortal in a headline online, as long as the internet remains here on Earth or actually outside in the universe somewhere. Why 100,000 bankers lost their jobs in 2015. So there were 100,000 disposable bankers. I saw this online. You were like a meme. You live on as a meme.
I'm immortal. I've been immortalized by this meme. Yeah. They didn't say my name. They didn't say what the reference was. I am the poster child for bankers losing their job and for banker suicides.
And we have another headline regarding a form of immortality, which is irreversibility. And that is lifelong damage caused to the children of Flint, Michigan. Flint, Michigan, it has a population of about 99,000. It used to have a population of closer to 150,000 just 20 years ago. Part of that, as you saw, caused Michigan. You've had emergency managers placed in, basically democracy suspended. The local councils are not to have any opinion. There's an emergency financial administrator. And unlike what 1975, what New York City had, you had in New York City when they went bankrupt, they had a council of people who were able to decide. Here in Michigan, they have one guy who gets to do things. And what they did in Flint, Michigan, is the emergency manager decided to turn off the water supply from Detroit and not pay Detroit for their water supply, and instead went to the Flint River. Because it looked on paper cheaper. But what happened is the water was filled with E. coli, ice sewage, or runoff from farms. So they had to put huge amounts of chlorine in it to get rid of that. That caused corrosion, also all the salt they put on the highways. So that caused corrosion in the lead pipes, which has caused massive brain damage now in all these kids in Michigan. In Flint, Michigan, there's so much lead in children's blood that a state emergency is declared. So almost immediately after the city started drawing water from the Flint River in April 2014, residents began complaining about the water, which they said was cloudy in appearance and emitted a foul odor. Since then, complications from the water coming from the Flint River have only piled up. Although city and state officials initially denied that the water was unsafe, the state issued a notice informing Flint residents that the water contained unlawful levels of trihalomethanes, a chlorine byproduct linked to cancer and other diseases, and also lead. There were citizens that demanded these financial emergency managers do tests 6 months ago because they were certain something was wrong. They refused. They wouldn't let them. So the citizens of the residents of Flint went to Virginia Tech and got them to do these independent tests, and they found it was like dangerous levels according to the EPA.
Well, of course, Flint, Michigan is where Roger Moore comes from. I should say. Gosh, I knew I was going to make that mistake. Michael Moore. I knew it in my head. I was going to say that. Of course, made Roger and Me, the seminal film, you know, about the car industry, General Motors in Flint in Michigan, leaving a carcass of a city, and it goes right into decline. And that's been decades ago. And it's just gotten situation's gotten worse. Now, if ISIS had done this to Flint, Michigan, the people would be outraged. They'd be like, we were attacked by terrorists, and they gave our kids lead poisoning, and they're trying to kill us. But because it was done by Americans to Americans in the name of American profits for the kleptocratic class, it's considered business as usual, nothing to see here, just keep drinking the lead water, we don't need kids, kids are disposable. And, you know, that's why they're, anyway, it's
so
quite hellacious.
They've had to come in. Rick Snyder has declared an emergency. $12 million was spent to rehook them up to Detroit. So that's $131 per resident of Flint, Michigan. So the cost, there was no cost savings. Everything is done for the cheap disposable cost, not caring about the long-term cost ever. Never the cost of doing studies to determine whether or not they could. So the water from Flint River, for example, was 19 times more corrosive than the Detroit water supply. So nobody ever did any tests then, but now that these children have irreversible damage, this is part of the reason why they've declared an emergency in order to get federal funds to take care of these children for the rest of their lives, because they'll have lower job sort of expectations, intelligence expectations, IQ, all that stuff will be damaged now irreversibly. So they have to rely on federal handouts because of somebody saved. I looked through the literature. I couldn't find how much they were actually saving, but I'm sure it was just a few bucks, and therefore disaster ensued.
Right, they make a fee by selling all this equipment in the short term, even though it's causing, basically it's an ecological holocaust, and the people of Flint don't seem to care about it, you know, so I'm not sure.
Well, there are big protests. They were talking about it's really freezing cold right now. All of them are going out there. But by the way, Virginia Tech showed that the level of lead in a lot of the water into the homes is hugely over toxic. But Flint managers say they still maintain that there's nothing wrong with it. Now I'm going to go back to another conflict between citizens of a collapsing empire and the ideology which refuses to look at real costs and cost-benefit analysis. Marco Rubio, he's a presidential candidate. He's also a senator. Well, he has signed a letter to the FCC. In this regards, Marco Rubio pushes to block low-cost, high-speed broadband. So Rubio, who is raising campaign cash from the telecom industry for his presidential campaign, fired off a letter to the Federal Communications Commission asking the agency to allow states to block municipal broadband services. So cities and municipalities across the U.S. have had basically, they have these oligopolies where there's only like one or two options for you to get broadband. So because they're the only two companies you can go to, there's no reason for them to invest in the actual service. Instead, they take bonuses for themselves. So what happened is in Chattanooga, for example, city officials set up a service known as the Gig, a municipal broadband network that provides data transfers at 1 gigabyte per second for less than $70 a month, a rate that is 50 times faster than the average speed American customers have available through private broadband networks. So now Marco Rubio is saying, we can't do this. This is socialism, and we need to let You know, always the argument is that these private companies can provide more efficient, faster, more advanced innovation, service, all this stuff. But the municipality of Chattanooga provided 50 times faster than the telecoms were able or willing to. And here you have a situation, a crisis between ideology and just basic facts of commerce of the world you live in.
Right. It's clearly going to hurt job growth. So anybody, politician, who would be against slowing down the internet is against job growth. And so why would they do that unless they were working for a corporation? So Marco Rubio is obviously working for the interest of a corporation who is trying to gouge the public domain and gouge government and rip them off.
And here's another thing. So you have increased costs for lower services. All across Europe, by the way, all across Asia, the internet speeds are far faster than the U.S. and far cheaper than in the U.S. This in a future where we're more connected, more globalized, and faster transactions. In a Bitcoin world, you see even Bitcoin companies, you know, they're all over in Europe rather than the U.S. Everything is being happening outside the empire where they're maintaining their ideology and also their oligopolies. Now, here is another story, which is remarkable because everywhere in the developed world, you have healthcare costs that are half of the price of what in America. But apparently, it's the only thing saving America from outright deflation. CPI's medical services component helped firm up core CPI the past 2 months. So it's only because the same service you're getting is going up in price every year, 10%, 20%. Same with education costs. They continue to rise. That's the only thing from keeping us from being in that deflation that the Fed and the central banks are trying to fight.
Right. Stuff that where you're physically bound to the location, like an education or health services, they have the freedom to raise prices in a completely anti-competitive way, in an oligopolistic way.
Yes.
Stuff that can be manufactured and shipped, that's allowed to go to Asia, China, and elsewhere, and you see costs drop down to zero, but they take all the jobs.
Yes.
So Americans are not allowed to have high-paying jobs because those are, or all the jobs are shipped overseas, but when they go to get healthcare or education, prices are going up exponentially because they haven't figured out a way to outsource that specifically, so they just create a monopoly with the cooperation of the government, who, of course, gets a huge fee as well.
So that's it, and Flint and Detroit will be immortal one day. The city itself might collapse, but lead pipes will still exist in 100 years' time.
Well, I can see the second half coming your way, so don't go away. Welcome back to the Kaiser Report. Time now to turn to Patrick Byrne. He's the CEO of Overstock.com. I've been waiting on this interview for a while. Patrick, welcome to the Kaiser Report.
Max, it's such an honor to be on with you and Stacy. But, you know, we've spoken a couple times before, and I feel like every time I talk to you, I should say, gosh, you're not in jail yet. I'm surprised when we speak that one of us is not in a jail or a gulag somewhere.
Well, you know, you've had your run-ins, I should say, or confrontations with Wall Street. You've been following your career for 10 years. And it's really remarkable, a career. But before we get into that, there has been a major announcement made this week at Inside Bitcoin, the conference, from Overstock.com, your company. Can you go into that and explain what's going on here? This is a major development in the Bitcoin and crypto in Overstock. Patrick, what's going on?
It is indeed. The SEC has sprinkled its holy water on our S3, on our shelf offering, to issue a crypto security. And we, early in the year, acquired an ATS, a dark pool, and got it rigged up. And we got FINRA and the SEC to spring holy water on it as an exchange that could trade crypto instruments. So now we have both the exchange that can do it, and we're the first company as of a few days ago, that has SEC approval to issue a crypto security. I have to take just a moment as a prophylactic measure and make clear it's understood this is not an offering to sell securities nor a solicitation of an offer to buy, et cetera, et cetera. California highway mileage will be lowered. Don't run with that stick. You'll poke someone's eye out. I'm not committing to sell any crypto securities.
Okay, understood, Patrick. Disclaimer, we're not making an offer here. Now, Patrick, I worked on Wall Street myself for many years. Now, there's a huge infrastructure on Wall Street, the back office, where people are matching trades, where people are doing offers, they're writing prospectuses, they are it's a lot of industry, is a lot of stuff that's numbnuts, day-to-day back office work. Would you put something on the blockchain? It's not so much the stock that we're talking about here. What we're talking about is that the whole infrastructure of Wall Street gets disintermediated, to use a new era word, and this collapses the cost of doing this type of thing, number one.
About 80 or 90% is all.
Right, so the cost collapsed by 80 or 90%, plus now I want to bring in some of the past of Patrick Byrne. So you, basically, your company, you felt that you were being attacked by short sellers, people who were making negative bets against your company, and they were doing so in a way that was, let's say, it was not in the spirit of the law. And we can talk about the technicalities of it in a little bit. But this offering on the blockchain from Overstock.com, this is part of a wave to eliminate all of those types of behaviors that we've seen in the past that are highly questionable. Is that correct statement? Would you say that's correct?
That's correct. Kaiser, I would say, I've watched your show many, many times. We've spoken a couple times. You're not just a pretty face. You've got, it's about collapsing the cost, but it's also about preventing the mischief. You know, my fight with Wall Street 10 years ago, which got extremely ugly, was always spun as being, well, this is a guy at Overstock, he's mad about Overstock. That's not really what happened. Can I give you a minute? Can you give me a minute or 30 seconds to explain what happened?
Well, I can explain to the audience what happened is that there's a regulation called Reg Show where trades are supposed to be matched in a timely manner, but you discovered that people who were selling stock that they didn't own was not ever matched in a timely manner, and therefore they could gang up and force the price of your stock down, and they're decapitalize your stock, and that's completely wrong.
You got it, Kaiser. I remember that you really understand the back office and have some patents and stuff, as I recall. Yeah, but it wasn't, here's the thing that's wrong about that. It wasn't about my stock, it really never was. I figured, so we went public in 2002, and when you're a public company CEO, you're out there in the mix. You're out there with the hedge funds, the Stevie Cohens, the prime brokers, the regulators. And by 2004, I smelled skunk. I knew there was a bunch of nonsense. I was asked to take part in it in expert network systems, which are just insider trading systems and such. And I sort of started mapping how all this stuff was going on. And I figured out there was a constellation of dirty hedge funds centered on Stephen Cohen that were trading on inside information, manipulating the market. They were going to crash the market. The SEC was kind of asleep at the switch 10 years ago, is what I was saying. And it was all actually leaving America open to economic warfare. When I said this stuff in 05, 06, they ran pictures of me with UFOs coming out of my head. What? It's a conspiracy theory to suggest the SEC and Wall Street are too tight close. But so that it was always spun as being, oh, it's just this guy mad about his stock. For me, I was always concerned about the country, the whole integrity. I come from the Holy Church of Capital Markets. When I found out, and it's funny, as a back office guy, you know, the front office people, they have no idea how the back office works. They get their position papers every morning at the hedge fund. They have no idea what's going on, how the actual plumbing of Wall Street works. You, who know how it works, knows how much slop there is in it. And there were ways that criminals could use that slop to do some real no goodnicks, got up to some mischief. So you're absolutely right. The real virtue of the blockchain is A, you know, it does eliminate 80 or 90% of the friction cost, but B, it eliminates all kinds of slop that is opportunity for the no goodnicks.
Well, Patrick, you know, when I was down in Greece, I went there many times to Athens, and I tried to explain to the Greek people and the Greek government that Wall Street bankers can use these types of tricks to destabilize, to collapse their economy, and now we see that the assets of Greece are being sold for pennies on the dollar after their economy was crashed using these Wall Street tricks. I don't know if you followed the Greece story, but would you agree with me that Greece has been victimized by Wall Street fraudsters using financialized weapons of mass destruction like credit default swaps in an illegal, improper way to destroy that country's economy? What do you think?
Yeah, it's all very related, led by Goldman Sachs, of course. who did all kinds of tricks, letting them hide their real leverage and real levels of debt. These techniques are all related. They're bear raids. You know, Michael Milken was the guy who took some mafia techniques, in particular something called a bust out, which is a mafia technique of taking over a local bar, leveraging it up with debt, sucking the cash out, and leaving it kaput. And Michael Milken, 25 years ago, took that into the world of high finance. And what has happened since then is these guys, these miscreants, I like to call them as sort of a general term, figured out how to move up the food chain. And they got into penny stocks, they got into small and mid-sized stocks. It was definitely, it's been whitewashed, but it was part of the 2008 collapse. And absolutely, they've moved all the way up to nationals, conducting bear raids on state-level actors like Greece. Now, I think Greece has its own fundamental problems. It's got a business model that doesn't
work.
Yeah,
but when you have guys like John Paulson involved, and when you have guys like Lloyd Blankfein and Goldman Sachs involved, they're doing exactly what you said, a torch job, like the mafia. They made out like bandits on the credit default swaps, and like Goldman Sachs was selling, products that they knew were faulty and were losing money to their own clients. So these guys are even worse than the mafia. The mafia has higher standards. But anyway, so your SEC approval for doing a security offering on the blockchain, and again, to just reiterate, this is not about the offer, but about the technology of it. So you have become a poster boy for the SEC. How did that happen? I mean, you're now loved by the SEC. How did that happen, Patrick?
Well, I wouldn't say I'm getting any flowers, but I have to, if there's anyone who's been a more vicious critic of the SEC than you, it was me. 10 years ago, we were kind of a two-man Occupy Wall Street, or I was a one-man Occupy Wall Street 10 years ago. I have to say this year, now that it's all over, so it's not about currying favor, I'll tell you, it's been quite remarkable working with the SEC in the last 7 months. We put the S3 in. Went through four rounds of them questioning, us responding, and then it finally got through. And this whole time, I think it's different leadership there, or it's a different attitude. People were extremely professional with me. I expected there to be memories of 10 years ago, and they were professional, and they I wouldn't say they put a mad rush on things, but they didn't slow things down. I was worried. If they were the SEC that they'd been under Chris Cox, they would have been protecting their client industry, i.e. Wall Street, against this innovation. Instead, they were professional and with reasonable dispatch, got through. They had a lot of legitimate questions.
So the SEC is on board, and I think a lot of their clients are now involved in the blockchain. So, Patrick, what do you make of the fact that a lot of banks are now getting into this blockchain business? But there is a separation here. You've got the private blockchains, like a Ripple, which our banks are using to cut costs to do interbank business. But it's a centralized chain, it's a private chain, and it's not the same as Bitcoin, which is decentralized. Bitcoin is secure because it's run by the miners. So you have a split in the crypto world. How do you fall in on this divide, if you will? Because there are the diehards who say Bitcoin is the pure, decentralized, secure network by miners, and these private blockchains by the banks are just them. It's like an intranet. It's just an imitation. It's just a big ledger. They're just trying to save money, and we need to keep the focus on Bitcoin. You take Bitcoin at Overstock.com. That's your focus. Where do you weigh in on this debate if you have an opinion?
I do have an opinion. Well, first, we built our system, which is called T0, to be ledger agnostic. It can work with Bitcoin's blockchain, or it can work with Circle, Ripple, Chain, any of those people we can integrate with in a couple of weeks, PureNova. So it's blockchain ledger agnostic. There are different virtues. These different commercial ledgers that are coming out are optimized around different things, transaction speed, secrecy, all kinds of things. So there isn't going to be one best solution. Now, so for that reason, I'm not sort of emotionally tied to just the Bitcoin blockchain. Now, all that said, the gist of your question is entirely correct. What is happening, I think, is there's a bunch of banks. There's really three groups on Wall Street: the exchanges, the settlement system, and the banks. Everybody has figured out, and I'm talking to all these people now, it's like a big Game of Thrones. Everybody has figured out that one of those groups is going to use the blockchain to disrupt the other two. And everybody's jockeying to try to figure out who's going to dance with who. And I think what's happening is some of the banks are forming consortia that have no purpose whatsoever, other than what they want to do is get the Goldman Sachs approved blockchain, or, for example, set as the national standard and as the standard. And it's just they want to indulge in regulatory capture again. Let's get their system accepted by the regulators, and then they'll prevent new competition. Was their plan, but with us getting approved, I think it could disrupt that plan of the banks.
Patrick, I hate to do it, but we got to cut it off there. Thanks for being on the Kaiser Report.
Honor. I'll come back anytime you want me. Thank you, Max.
Fantastic. All right. Well, that's going to do it for this episode of the Kaiser Report with me, Max Kaiser, and Stacey Herbert. I'd like to thank our special guest, Patrick Byrne, CEO of Overstock.com. If you want to tweet us, you can do so on Twitter @KaiserReport. Until next time, bye, y'all.